ओके ऑल राइट.
वी आर लाइव नाउ।
Very warm welcome to all of you to the digital edition of the roadshow on the opportunities for investment in stressed assets in India. As we all know, many of our lenders and creditors have been saddled with stressed assets. A number of factors such as the global slowdown, business failures, governance issues, etc., did lead to this unfortunate situation. And the IBC subsequently got legislated in 2016, and in 4 years' time, 3,900 corporates have undergone a resolution process under this evolutionary legislation. And this number is only an indicator of the confidence and trust that has been placed in this India's new insolvency regime. IBC has also led to a very marked improvement in country's credit culture, which is indeed a very, very positive sign. And as we were gearing up to celebrate the success of this landmark reform, the pandemic has struck and I think has given a bit of a setback. But India still has, there are a lot of potential companies which may be stressed, but viable there. So therefore, at this juncture, it is imperative to maintain the financial stability and provide avenues to lenders and creditors to be able to relieve their NPAs. And both government and regulator have done tremendous work, to support companies in the stressed assets area, which has emerged due to the COVID scenario. Today's platform, which FICCI has created, is essentially to catalyze discussions on various avenues that are available for investment in stressed assets in India, and invite investors to participate in profitable turnaround opportunities in currently stressed but otherwise viable businesses, who could be better than the kind of panel that we have with us today. Very warm welcome to Dr. M.S. Sahu, Chairman IBBI. Dr. Sahu has always been very supportive of FICCI's initiative, and sir, it is your guidance and enthusiasm which has kept us going in this space, physically and virtually. Both you have supported us extensively in this. Welcome Mr. Rajneesh Kumar, Chairman, State Bank of India, who is with us today. So we look forward to hearing the perspective of country's largest bank in this space, and of course you being a veteran banker. Mr. Sunil Mehta, another veteran banker with us, who currently is the Chief Executive of Indian Banks Association, and we partner with him a lot of initiatives, and he's also the Member Secretary of the Kamath Committee looking at one-time restructuring, so very important perspective will come from him. Extremely grateful to the Consulate of India in New York for partnering with FICCI for today's initiative. Delighted to have His Excellency Mr. Randhir Jaiswal, Consul General of India in New York, for joining us this conference. We've done several physical conferences at your wonderful facility in New York, but this time, of course, it's virtual. So thank you for partnering and joining in your morning with our evening. So welcome again, sir. Mr. Shardul Shroff, of course, our constant partner in this endeavor. Thank you for being there. PwC, SE Sanjeev with us. And of course, Mr. Dilip Chinoy, the Secretary General FICCI, who does have a lot of deep insights in the policy perspectives, who's also with us this evening, for this very important event. Before I invite Mr. Rashish Shah, who's past President FICCI, to deliver the opening address, just a brief introduction. Mr. Rashish Shah is the Chairman and CEO of Edelweiss Group, which is one of the India's leading diversified financial conglomerates and businesses ranging across credit businesses, non-credit businesses, and life insurance. He's very passionate about financial services and the role that can play in translating India's vast savings into investments, a great guiding spirit for FICCI in many ways. And of course, one of the, he also has deep insights in the stressed assets area, leading and supporting one of India's largest asset reconstruction company. With these words, over to you, Mr. Shah, for your opening address, please. Kindly unmute yourself, Mr. Shah.
Yes. Thank you, Jyoti, and thanks to all of you for being with us today and giving me this opportunity. Though we are calling this a roadshow, we are all getting used to this new virtual way of interacting, but truly happy we could find the time between India and US. And we have a great set of speakers for this today. And I think we are a very esteemed audience. And it just shows how important this entire opportunity is for all of us. But before I start, I do wish that I hope that all of you are doing well. Everybody is, you know, we and our families are keeping well. So here's wishing all of you, you know, a very healthy future going forward. And I want to extend a very warm welcome to Dr. M.S. Sahu. Dr. Sahu is the steward for this entire insolvency bankruptcy code in India. He has been a leading guide on that. And over the last 3-4 years, I have seen the kind of path-breaking work IBBI has done under his stewardship and continues to do. I think every quarter something new is happening. And these are truly, when we look into the future and we look back, we'll see this was the really early days where the foundation of this path-breaking bankruptcy code was laid. And IBBI and Dr. Sahu are the stewards of that. Also extremely privileged that we have the chairman of State Bank of India, Mr. Rajneesh Kumar, who is obviously also in the last 3-4 years has amongst the many things he's done, he's also been very active in resolving stressed assets, recovering, not on behalf of just State Bank of India, but as a leader, as a leading bank, as a leader for all the other banks and financial institutions in India, and has a lot of insights and experience on this, which I'm very happy to have interacted with him on many of these assets. We also have Mr. Sunil Mehta, CEO of IBA. Mr. Mehta also as PNB chairman has a lot of experience. Then we have Mr. G.K. Singh, Joint Secretary, Corporate Affairs. Amongst this, I think there is a huge amount of insight and perspective available. Of course, today's event would not have been possible without the support of Consulate General of India in New York. And we are extremely grateful to His Excellency, Mr. Randhir Jaiswal, Consulate General of India in New York, for giving us this opportunity. As Jyoti said, we have done this earlier in New York with you, and this is our opportunity to interact with a lot of investors in the US thanks to you. In the stressed market in India, everybody has made estimates about $150 billion. But I think the genesis of this is because India is going through a very unique phase of transformation as well as growth at the same time. As we are growing and we are transforming, there is some sort of creative destruction also happening. We have seen a huge amount of growth in the last 20 years, but we have also seen the buildup of stress and stressed assets in the banking system, in the NBFCs and all in the last few years, which has presented with a very great and unique opportunity for investors who have the capital, who have the expertise to tackle this. There was a point of time we had estimated that the almost 10% of the banking assets, which are about close to about a trillion rupees, about 10% of that was stressed and available. But here I must draw a very important distinction. And from my own personal experience in our ARC, we have realized that actually assets are not stressed. It's the balance sheet or the promoters or the sponsors who are stressed. And very often, very high quality assets fall on bad times because of lack of working capital or last mile funding, just because the balance sheet or the promoters don't have the capability to be able to, you know, to manage that. So we always say that India has got some really gold-plated assets, some fabulous assets available, but it's the balance sheets which have got stressed. And part of it has got stressed because over the last few years, you know, interest rates have come down. A lot of asset inflation, which people were dependent on, has not happened. Project implementation for various reasons has not gone as per schedule. So a lot of assets are brownfield. They are 80%, 90% completed. They need last mile funding. They need operating efficiency. They need a lot of hand. with multiple assets, a lot of non-core assets which can be sold off. But for in order to do all this, what we need is long-term, stable and flexible capital. Indian banking system has done what it can. Even the Indian bond market and all are not able to do much because this kind of capital is to be available in a particular format, in an AIF or a closed-ended fund format, and the horizon required is between 5 to 10 years. So getting long-term capital, getting flexible capital, along with the ability to handhold and turn around assets, revive them. And I must compliment Dr. Sahu and others that Indian entire stressor opportunity has not been about selling assets or about liquidating assets, though in a few cases that is inevitable. A large opportunity is revival, restructuring, revival and resolving it. And there are many ways. Capital is required, expertise is required, but by providing last mile funding, providing senior financing, providing non-core asset sales, lot of M&A, a lot of restructuring can be done to make this assets productive, because these are also assets for the country. This is a large opportunity for the country also. It's an opportunity for investors to make good returns, and I think that has to be the primacy of any approach of capital markets, to make sure that investors get the right return on their risk. But even for the country, this is very important. So we are at that stage, and coincidentally, we got our bankruptcy code a few years ago when we were a $2.5 trillion the GDP country, which coincidentally was the US was in 1980. So we are very similar to size of the economy of USA in 1980, which was also the time that the bankruptcy code in US came into play. So in a sense, I think this is at the right time. The bankruptcy code has come about. It has changed creditor behavior. It has changed ability and the ability to maneuver this. And from first-hand experience, I say this is a great opportunity and it will be there for a long time. There are a lot of assets in India which require long-term, flexible, structured capital. There are a lot of assets which require good sponsors who can help with operating efficiency. And I think with the banking system, we can work very closely. I've seen the banking system also has become very proactive in the last few years. So foreign investors like all of you and the Indian players, Indian banking industry and financial institutions and ARCs, like all of us, we have a great opportunity to go forward and really create a win-win-win out of this. So along with that, I would say once again, thank you to all of you for being here and thanks for giving me this opportunity. Over to you, Jyoti. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shah. Of course, you said the balance sheet and the promoters may be stressed, but not assets, and exactly the opportunity for foreign investors. Very important message here. Thank you so much. May I now turn to Mr. Randhir Jaiswal, as I said, Council General of India and New York. Mr. Jaiswal is a career diplomat, has joined IFS in 1998, served in various countries in very important roles, also at the center in the Ministry of External Affairs. And while I add my thanks for partnering with us, as soon as you stepped into this role, when you reached New York and supported us, may I now request you to kindly deliver the welcome address. Please, over to you, Mr. Jaiswal. You will have to unmute yourself, sir. Mr. Jaiswal, kindly unmute yourself. Sir, you're on mute. Mr. Jaiswal, can you hear us? You're on mute, sir.
I have to tell them again.
I think they are trying to figure out the way of unmuting.
Over to you, Mr. Jaiswal, for your welcome address, please.
Yes, we can hear you. Can you hear us?
Yes, we can hear you, sir. Loud and clear.
Well, sorry for that glitch.
Very good. Good evening, everybody in India, and good morning, everybody here in the United States. It is a pleasure for us to partner with FICCI on this digital roadshow. We have done this in the past, but you know, today we are living in different times, and therefore we have to come around in this particular format. But going forward, I would like to convey to all our stakeholders and FICCI that we are here to support you. We are here to do whatever is best for our investors here in the United States and those interested in India who need some support here in New York. This particular partnership, India-US relations, is a very important partnership of which our economic relations happen to be a very strong pillar. Trade flows between the two countries, investment flow between the two countries have been going on, have been growing. And even though we are in the middle of this pandemic, we are optimistic about things to shape up in future. During the COVID-19 pandemic also, India and the United States are together looking at solutions for COVID-19. There are several vaccine candidates in which both the countries are involved. You know, recently, there is a very strong political commitment to take forward the reforms in spite of COVID-19. We have announced in India a slew of reforms that have encouraged our stakeholders here in the United States, especially in the sectors of financial services, space, where we've opened private participation, agriculture and food processing, the health sector, so on and so forth. Civil aviation, again, is an important sector where we expect a lot more things to happen between the United States and India. Recently, the Prime Minister has given a call for Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is essentially, very simply put, to strengthen our capacities back home in India so that we can bring in a lot more strength, a lot more resilience in the global supply chains. We are also working hard here in the United States to strengthen, to position ourselves as an important destination on the global supply chain. It is in this background where we all are trying to press the pedal on our growth path that this particular digital roadshow is being organized. Opportunities for investment in stressed assets in India. Mr. Rasesh Shah has very beautifully brought out what exactly lies in store for people who are looking at new opportunities in India. Even though, you know, we are talking of stressed assets, but we are actually talking about real viable business propositions. I'm sure I look forward to hearing, and all our viewers and participants are looking forward to hearing more from the stalwarts that we have on the panel today. And we are here in the consulate to do our best to support Indian companies, to support American companies and stakeholders who are looking to tie up with opportunities in India. So with these words, I think we should give more time to the specialists to talk about the opportunities. I would like to once again thank FICCI. We are delighted to partner with you, and we are here to strengthen and support you in all your initiatives and endeavor here in the United States and in New York. So over to you. Thank you, everybody, and I look forward to this discussion today.
Thank you, sir. Indeed, the New York Consulate is really working hard. We've been there. We've seen all the activity and a lot of support from your side always as and when we've sought one. May I now turn to Mr. Sunil Mehta, the CEO of Indian Banks Association, as I earlier also mentioned, a former managing director and CEO of Punjab National Bank, a career banker. He has done a tremendous amount of work while in the space of banking career. As I mentioned earlier also, he's the member secretary of RBI committee under KV Kamath, constituted to recommend parameters for loan restructuring. Very effective work done by the committee, and the guidelines are out for everyone to see and comment. May I now request Mr. Sunil Mehta, kindly, sir, for your theme address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Jyoti, and I really thank FICCI as well as Consulate General of India in New York, Jaiswal ji, for providing us this opportunity to interact with the investors based in the US for investing in stress assets back home. In fact, the opportunity was never so lucrative as it is today. There are various defining factors, and the most important factor, as Rashish ji and the Jyoti has already told, is the legislation that IBC has been enacted in India, and which has made the transition of assets from one corporate to the another in a very smooth way. The introduction of Section 29A in this legislation has really opened up the new avenues for a fresh investor, because this section do not allow the existing investor or existing owner to bid for his own asset as a resolution applicant. So resolution applicant has to be an outside investor, and for a bigger size investor, you need a larger capital to invest, and where the role of institutional investors from abroad who can come and chip in. Because domestic ARCs may have a limitations on capital, and the size of the kitty is very big. The stress has not only been created by COVID. COVID is just a last leg of it. It has it is there in the system, and mainly it has come because of the restructurings and the certain political changes that has happened in the country in forms of cancellation of the coal blocks, in terms of different policy changes that has happened and impacted the various industries. And those industries, as very, very rightly said by Rashish ji, the industries are healthy. Maybe their promoters have lost the capacities to bring fresh capital, and that's why they need a new promoter to come in and chip into the process. I can tell you the support the banking system is giving, encouraging to the new investor is all-time new. You must have seen the transition, the smooth transition which has happened in case of Bhushan Steel, that has happened in case of Star Steel. Such a large size assets were very smoothly transferred to the new promoters like ArcelorMittal and the Tata, and then they are operating and they are making good EBITDA margins also on the same assets. And I think the very short run, they have proved their capacities, and it has brought to the fore that the assets were not stressed. It is basically the promoters' abilities were stressed to bring them back to the proper potential. And this offers a very great opportunity for all the institutional investors. Because this is a time where you are getting the value at a very fine valuations, because of the multiple reasons. A stress time, global economy is under stress, and best investment opportunities. India is blessed with the largest younger generation, which has the capacities to produce as well as the consume. So here you will get not only the people who can work on those projects, you will get the people who will consume the product which will be produced domestically. So it provides all the three options: a very fantastic valuations available, a very able and technically dedicated workforce available, and a very good market available, even locally, and with the potential to go for exports also. Even the recent changes that has been brought by the Indian government in doing the ease of the business, that is also a very facilitating factor for all the foreign investors to come in and chip in. And I think a lot of the foreign investors have already started showing interest. They have already acquired few assets at a very reasonable valuation. And this window may not last for a very long time, because a stage has come where the Indian corporates have become started learning the importance of remaining financially disciplined. And that financial discipline will definitely reduce the future companies coming to the market for investment by the institutional investor. So my request to all the investors will be, look at these opportunities. I will provide you all type of support that you may need from India, maybe from the banking system, maybe from the entire ecosystem. And of course, this will be a win-win situation for all stakeholders. The investors will get an asset at a very low valuation. They will get a very attractive business propositions because the assets are in good shape, and the Indian banking system will also get a benefit for finding a new investors which can bring the capitals and bring those projects within their ranges for providing the additional funding or incremental fundings to make them the sustainable viable units for the times to come. I hope this interaction will really be beneficial to the all stakeholder, and I thank you all for providing me this opportunity to interact with you.
Thank you, sir. Indeed, the India opportunity is now and every must look at it, as you rightly said, and the banking system is providing a lot of support to everybody. So we have another very senior banker with us, Mr. Rajneesh Kumar, chairman of the India's largest bank, the State Bank of India. He's been the chairman of this bank since 7th October 2017. Has a three-decade career with the State Bank, obviously having done in-depth work across the bank, also been in various subsidiaries like the State Bank, SBI Capital Markets, etc. He's brought in a lot of reforms, a lot of changes. We also know the kind of support he's been providing to, you know, the evolving technologies and stuff. He's also worked in a lot of overseas markets as well as part of the State Bank system. And he's also currently the chairman of Indian Banks Association. So may I now request Mr. Rajneesh Kumar to kindly deliver the keynote address, please. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much for kind introduction. And I must compliment FICCI and the Consular General of India to have this digital roadshow, if I can call it a roadshow or a digital show. And the time is most appropriate because in the COVID-19 situation, various estimates are going around about the stress which can emerge across the globe. Not only India, and India is no exception. And the estimates about the opportunity vary. As the State Bank of India, I have a little bit of contrarian view, and I don't want to disappoint the potential investors. But from the analysis of my own book, loan book with the State Bank of India, I feel the opportunity may not be as large as it is being made out. So, and that would be a happy situation for the country as a whole, and all of us should wish that this opportunity remains small and not large. But still, even if it is small, the size itself is fairly okay for any potential investors to have a look at the market. And the two major, I would say, the governing laws, or rather three, around the resolution of stressed assets when we are talking about. And after me, I am seeing that Dr. Sahu will be delivering his inaugural address. And he is an expert on all the legal position around the resolution of stressed assets. But three major laws, the Companies Act itself, the IBC, which was introduced in 2016, and the resolution framework of 7 June 2019 by Reserve Bank of India. These are broadly the three major legal framework or regulatory framework under which a resolution of stressed assets can happen. So if it is a sort of a financial entity like a NBFC, then currently the governing law is the Companies Act, and Reserve Bank of India as a regulator have the powers and their approval is required. IBC is a new law in the country, and again I can say as a beneficiary of that law, in the sense that we are the bank and we have the distinction, if I can call it a distinction. It can be even called a dubious distinction of having the largest stressed asset portfolio in the country, but not in terms of the percentage of our portfolio. If it is taken as the percentage of our loan portfolio, then we don't have that distinction. But otherwise, by its absolute size, our portfolio is very large, and it is about now almost 1.5 trillion rupees. But IBC 2016, that is definitely changed and brought a paradigm shift as far as the dealing with the industrial sickness or the resolution of stressed assets is concerned. And here, the IBBI, which is headed by Dr. Sahu, the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, the lenders community as represented by IBA, They all have worked in close coordination and along with the regulators to make the necessary amendments wherever required. And I would consider it to be an achievement for a country that within 4 years, or rather even 3.5 years of its implementation, what it has achieved. And many high profile cases which were in the domain domestically and in internationally, well known cases, and there have been resolutions. We may not be happy with the pace that the cases got resolved in 2.5 years, but it has to be compared when, in the absence of IBC framework, there was no time frame. We had a very antiquated BIFR mechanism or a DRT where the cases would never get resolved. So when we talk about the delays or the time taken to resolve the cases, it in terms of relative terms, this is a much, much improved situation. And further steps have been taken by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs to augment the infrastructure around dealing the cases. And initially there was a rush. Of course, unfortunately, COVID-19 has again come, and there is currently immediately no rush because it has been kept in abeyance for 6 months, because any debt under COVID-19, it cannot be taken to the through the IBC process for next 6 months. But that should not and does not matter, because in any case, the resolution framework of Reserve Bank of India also gives a window of about 6 months to arriving at a resolution framework. And only if the lenders don't succeed in that 6 months period, then they have the choice to take it through legal process, whether it is DRT or whether it is a company law tribunal. And for everyone, it has been a learning experience, including the lenders. And initially, all lenders thought, and maybe even today we think, that for us, what matters is the recovery. But on several occasions, Dr. Sau and I, myself, have made it abundantly clear that the purpose of IBC is resolution, and it is not a recovery mechanism for the bankers. And the preserving the value of the enterprise is of utmost importance. And the speed is of essence. And that is where, of course, the infrastructure needs to be augmented. Everybody realizes that, and the steps are being taken. But still, there is enough regulatory leeway available today to even resolve any stress outside the legal framework. And that is where the 7 June 2019 framework of Reserve Bank of India, it assumes importance. And a special window has also been provided, considering the COVID-19 situation, where any corporate who have been impacted, and for that matter, even for the first time, even the retail loans have been covered, where certain dispensations have been given by the Reserve Bank of India, and any stressed asset, the lenders have time, and the lenders and boss have time, that up to 31st December 2021, we can decide whether we want to take benefit of that window and whether any borrower is eligible for that window. And then within the next 6 months of December 2021, a resolution plan can be prepared. So even outside the legal process, the regulatory framework of Reserve Bank of India itself is providing the rules and the regulations and the manner in which the stress of the corporates as well as the retail can be taken care of. RBI appointed a committee under KV Kamath, and that committee also have given the benchmarks and the rules. So to that extent, there is complete clarity about the rules as well as the manner in which stress And I think for the investors who are attending this, for them, the corporate account sisters would be probably of more interest and relevance. So that framework is very clear. And there is no or are no major issues around it. The way to go about is either be part of an asset reconstruction company or AIF. Currently, of course, the advantage with ARC is that they become the secured creditor. That benefit as of now is not available to AIF. And AIF, the governing law, the SEBI regulates it, and there are both, I think, category one and there are category two. So category one alternate investment funds and category two alternate investment funds, both can invest in the stressed assets. And but mostly it is category one. And ourselves, State Bank of India, through one of our step down subsidiaries for real estate, we have set up a fund, category one alternate investment fund, and that is specific to the stressed assets in the real estate. And real estate, of course, we were witnessing stress for quite some time, and COVID-19 has accentuated that crisis or put more stress on the this sector. But real estate, aviation, power generation, these are some of the sectors where stress is visible. And although there are 26 sectors which have been identified by the Kamath Committee under the stress sector, but and of course the anything to do with the travel and tourism. So there are opportunities, and these are the governing framework. That is what I thought I should talk about this thing. And any investor, if they want any information, want to work jointly with the State Bank of India, so I can take this opportunity to market my bank, that we can provide all the help, and we can provide and are willing to join hands also with potential investors and can be a local partner. So thank you very much to FICCI and the Consul General for organizing this and giving me this opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir. You provided the entire framework and, of course, great opportunity to investors to work with you in this potential area. Thank you again, sir, for joining in. May I now request Dr. M.S. Sahu. We've already kind of, he's the chairman of IBBI, a great expert in the step check, one of the architects of the legislation. He's an acclaimed thought leader in the area of securities market and a distinguished public servant. Currently, of course, he's in IBBI, but he's served in Competition Commission of India. He's served in SEBI, also in Department of Economic Affairs at the Ministry of Finance. A great thought leader that we know personally. And with my word of thanks, sir, I would now invite you to kindly make your inaugural address, please. Over to you, Dr. Sahu.
Thank you very much. His Excellency Mr. Jaiswal, CGI in New York, dear investor friends from the US, and my colleagues from India, I am extremely pleased to join you over this video link to be a part of this program. Thanks to FICCI for having invited me. It has been mentioned that the reforms, Indian insolvency reforms, came just 3-4 years ago, with the enactment of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. In no time, it became a reform by the stakeholders, of the stakeholders, for the stakeholders. 4 years into the reform, the outcomes speak for themselves. Speed, it has been unparalleled. India did not have any prior experience of such a modern law. We learned on the go, but the institutions required for operationalizing the law, many of the institutions did not exist. Law had to be laid down. infrastructure to be created, capacity to be built, the professions have to be developed, market practices have to develop, stakeholders have to learn, accept the change and learn and how to use it. Yet the entire regulatory framework and the entire ecosystem for corporate insolvency was put in place so that these transactions commenced in 2016 itself. There has been all-round commitment from every possible stakeholder as well as authority. There were several challenges, of course, a law of such significance expected to throw up challenges. But all of us took the challenge head on and resolved them expeditiously. The central government made several changes in the laws relating to banking, revenue, companies. Very large corporates were pushed into the so-called 12 big large accounts, were pushed into this insolvency resolution process in the very early days. The adjudicating authority, the appellate authority, Honorable Supreme Court of the country, they have delivered numerous landmark orders to explain several conceptual issues and settle contentious issues with alacrity. The court has passed the constitutional muster. A standing committee called Insolvency Law Committee continuously reviews the implementation of the code to identify issues and address them. An economic law is being an essential empiric. It evolves continuously through experimentation. This code has been a road under construction for good reasons. It envisaged a standard plain vanilla process to start with, but anticipated prompt course corrections to continue to remain in the service of the business and economy. Such corrections arose from difficulties encountered while implementing the provisions of the code and from changes in the economic environment, including the recent COVID pandemic. The code has witnessed 5 legislative interventions since its enactment in sync with market realities, and each of these amendments is a milestone reinforcing the primary objective of the code, that is rescuing the lives of the companies. I would not like to cite the numbers of transactions, the professionals, all that, everything is in place. But as I just mentioned, the primary objective of the code is rescuing the lives of farmers in distress. Till June 2020, the code has rescued about 250 such farms through resolution plans, 1/3 of which were in a deep distress, being a defunct or sick company. And while rescuing these companies, the creditors have recovered nearly 200% of the liquidation value of the companies when they entered into the process. Any other option would have given the liquidation value of rupees 100, company would have died, but company survived, and additional 100 rupees is a bonus from the court. Beyond revival of the farms and the realization for the creditors, the credible threat of the court that a farm may change hands has redefined the debtor-creditor relationship, prompting resolutions in the shadow of the court, and substantial recoveries and resolutions are happening outside the court. And as Honorable Supreme Court mentioned in another context, that this gives an impression that defaulters' paradise is lost. So today, debtors prefer to resolve stress at early stages and make best effort to avoid the consequences of the resolution process. The court has established the supremacy of the market while balancing the powers of suppliers of capital, debt, and equity. It enables a market mechanism, the stakeholders themselves to decide the matters for them instead of accepting a solution thrust upon them by the state, which used to happen some time ago. The right of the promoters to cling on to the farm irrespective of its conduct is no more divine, with several farms changing hands despite valiant battles by some of them going up to Supreme Court repeatedly. The data about the time taken, costs for transactions, all these are available in the IBBA publication. But there has been a general recognition. It's got reflected in the ease of doing business ranking of the World Bank. In their report, India moved up, India's rank moved up in terms of the parameter resolving insolvency from 136 to 52nd position in the last 3 years. The recovery rate as per the World Bank data improved from 26 to 71.6 cents on dollar, and time taken for resolving insolvency reduced from 4.3 years to 1.6 years. India is now by far the best performer in South Asia on resolving insolvency and does better than the average of OECD high-income economies in terms of recovery rate, time taken, cost of the process. And very recently, Global Innovation Index has come out. They are also India's rank in terms of, again, resolving insolvency has improved in last 3 years from 111 to 47. At this stage, the world came across the COVID pandemic. What is unique or so rare about this event is that the great amount of uncertainty surrounding it, making it almost impossible to think ahead. It has fast snowballed into an economic crisis of dimensions being compared to those of the Great Depression. With many countries having passed through long periods of lockdown to contain the spread of the virus, the economic activity across the world had come to a standstill till about end of May and is now limping back to a new normal, albeit at a snail's pace. This unprecedented misery required a matching response to save lives. That required saving livelihood, which in turn required saving lives of the companies. Governments around the world have adopted an accommodative stance, acted very swiftly to prevent corporates and individuals from being forced into insolvency and bankruptcy proceedings for force majeure circumstances. In normal circumstances, the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code enables market forces to pursue twin complementary remedies in respect of a failing firm, rescue a viable firm, and liquidate an unviable one. Typically, it searches for a white knight, a clean person. We have something called Section 29A, which debars not credible people to submit resolution plans. So such a white knight should come and rescue a failing firm. When every firm, every industry, and every company is reeling under stress, the likelihood of finding such a white knight to rescue a failing firm is remote. If all failing firms were to undergo insolvency proceedings, most of them may end up with liquidation for want of saviors to rescue them. And upon such liquidation, the firms would have premature death, but the assets would have distressed sell, realizing abysmally little for the creditors. Rescuing lives of firms being the prime objective of the court, this could not be used to take away their lives prematurely at these unusual times. So this required another course correction, context-specific correction with a clear sunset clause. Contrary to the general belief that the code has been suspended, it is in fact a keyhole surgery that suspends a minute part of the code and suspends only for a short period. It suspends filing of applications for initiation of insolvency proceedings against a company for any default arising during COVID period. COVID period begins from 25th March, continues for 6 months, which can be extended up to 1 year if warranted. The objective being to insulate a company which did not have a default as on 25th March before the onset of lockdown in India, that happened on 24th March midnight, but committed a default for the first time, obviously because of the COVID, that needs to be protected. but the ordinance does not absolve the company from the default, does not exclude this default from the ambit of a definition of a default. Default remains a default for all purposes under the code except for initiating insolvency proceeding. It could be a basis for submission of a claim, could be basis for initiation of insolvency proceeding against a personal guarantor. So its impact is very limited only during a short period of time, fresh defaults arising. That much is kept outside the provisions of the insolvency proceeding. The code also clarifies that an application can be filed for initiating insolvency against a company for defaults committed before 25th March. It does not suspend the applications already filed before the adjudicating authority pending for admission, does not disturb ongoing proceedings, resolution, liquidation, result, including voluntary liquidation, does not suspend proceedings relating to personal guarantors and even financial service providers. There is a carve out has been provided under the insolvency code to resolve insolvencies of financial service providers, and one such financial service provider is undergoing this process. So this is only a very small part of the law that has been suspended. Now, coming back to the investment opportunities, a distressed asset has a life cycle. As I just mentioned, that there's a credible threat that company may change hands. That has changed the behavior of the debtors, and many accounts are becoming standard accounts. Many debtors are addressing the stress at early stage of the life of a distressed asset. And each of these stages is an entry point for investment in a distressed asset. An investor may invest in distressed asset when a debtor is facing an impending default. Default is imminent, default has not happened, and is trying to avoid default, which can push the company into insolvency proceeding and its attendant consequences. The investment can happen also when a debtor has received a notice from a personal creditor demanding a payment before initiating insolvency proceeding, and he is trying to preempt filing of an application for initiation of CIRP. These are the stages where distress is resolved without going through the regular process. In fact, the insolvency law's objective is that it should be used to the minimum and resolution should happen, preferably outside the code if it is possible. Even after an application has been filed for initiating insolvency proceeding, it is yet to be admitted. The debtor tries to preempt commencement of proceeding, and we have data at this stage about 12,000-13,000 applications have been withdrawn or arriving at a resolution of stress. After the resolution proceeding has commenced, but the applicant may be willing to withdraw the application, there's a provision of withdrawal with the approval of 90% voting power of the committee of creditors. After all these stages, the resolution professional has invited resolution plan. Investor can come in alone or in partnership with somebody to submit a resolution plan. A liquidation order has been passed, but there is a proposal for compromise or arrangement under the Companies Act. Or a liquidator proposes to sell the debtor or the business of the debtor as a going concern. So these are the possible entry points for an investor to invest in distressed asset. Besides that, they can buy the assets, distressed assets, as Mr. Rajesh Kumar was mentioning, from SBI or many other creditors who are willing to sell, get dispose of the distressed asset at any time of the life cycle. And what also Mr. Rajesh Kumar has mentioned, that we do not have that much as a percentage, that many distressed assets. But given the size of the economy, I just mentioned about the ease of doing business score, global innovation index score, competitiveness score, with a large economy like India, which is considered in terms of purchasing power parity, second largest economy, otherwise fifth or sixth largest economy. With the kind of competition and innovation we have, there will be companies who will not be able to run at the same speed as the fastest person is doing. Or take the situation of COVID now. At this time, this you can compare with a situation of innovation. The rule of the law has changed, rule of the game has changed, ground realities are different. Some industries are dying, new industries are coming up. This shows that some industries require resolution. So though the percentage of the entities requiring resolution is less, but for an economic size of India, there is and there will remain a steady flow of distressed assets. Number of assets available for resolution is extremely large, and there are obviously limitations on the extent of availability of domestic capital, leaving huge headroom for foreign investment. And these are available at attractive prices. I can compare because I had the experience of working in the securities market, the initial reforms of the 90s when the foreigners did not have access to Indian market and Indians did not have access to foreign market. We started in a limited way something called global deposit receipts, American deposit receipts. That was the first kind of access allowing foreigners to invest in India. And now things have moved much, much beyond now. Almost there are very liberal FDI, FII rules, capital the limits, sectoral limits. But the people who invested in the early days, say 92 to say the decade of the entire decade, 90s, they benefited the most because in initial days, when competition is not very high, when participation is relatively less, when the demand is relatively less, the market is attractive. So we are now passing through that stage, leaving aside COVID pandemic that which has depressed the market a little further, but we also have the silver lining that the stock markets are back to normal. The stock market in Indian context, it was the kind of lowest on 23rd March, the day before we started the lockdown. And now it is probably the highest or almost the highest we have, whatever the highest we had in January, February, the stock market has come back to the same normal pricing. But the market for the distressed assets are still available at attractive prices. And these are available with no strings attached. There is certainty, there is clarity. Even there is a recent amendment in the law which says that the liability of a corporate debtor for an offense committed prior to the insolvency proceeding shall cease, and corporate debtor shall not be prosecuted for such an offense from the debt resolution plan is approved. Similarly, no action shall be taken in respect of a property of the corporate debtor in relation to any offense committed prior to the insolvency proceeding by the erstwhile management or erstwhile companies, but subject to condition that this really results in the change of management or control of the city. So that means it's a clean title, and the other issues like the who will get how much in the resolution process, those have been settled by the parliamentary law, has been sanctified by the Supreme Court of India. So leaving aside the pandemic, now that huge steady flow of distressed assets with no strings attached at attractive prices, coupled with the fact that as a long-term investor, pandemic is there, it has affected every economy, India is no exception, we all of know that. But as a long-term investor, you look at the long-term perspective potential of the Indian economy over the next one decade or two decades. Unquestionably, it is established over the last few years that India is the fastest growing economy, faster than some of its contemporaries among the emerging economies. And over the next decade or so, I think it's likely to maintain a high growth rate. There's no economy, in fact, from 92 to 2020, 30 years at a stretch, on average, the growth rate of India has been 7+% and aspiring to grow at 10% sometime. So this is the time when anyone wants to invest in such a distressed assets, which are available through a clean process, resolution process, sacrosanct process with the blessings of the adjudicating authority, which is going to be where India is going to be one of the largest markets in the world. So given the future potential, given the fair way IBC is proceeding, where the state has no role, the market decides and professional is there to guide, I think it's a great opportunity for the investors and those who are really seriously thinking to invest in India. There cannot be a better opportunity than the present one available under the code. To me, this is the right time in the right place to be in India for these kinds of investments. Thank you. Thanks to Vicky for think Vicky and CGI for giving me this opportunity. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. As always, I mean, it's always great pleasure to listen to all the nuances, not only of the Act, but also about the investment opportunities in India. Of course, a great thinker, as I said. Thank you, sir, once again for joining in. May I now turn to Mr. Shardul Shroff. He chairs the FICCI National Committee on Stressed Assets and, of course, the executive chairman of Shardul Amarchand Mangaldas and Company. And Shardul, of course, always guides us and supports in his all IBC-related matters. So over to you, Shardul, for your concluding remarks, maybe 7-8 minutes from your side. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jyoti. Thank you for this opportunity for speaking on behalf of FICCI itself and making a presentation in relation to the market advantages of assets acquisition in the space of distressed assets. I think a lot has been said by several speakers who have spoken before me, but I would like to just summarize the 4 or 5 advantages of participating in relation to the market of stressed assets. The form of acquisition today is quite widespread and great opportunities in terms of modes of acquisition. You could acquire the company, you could acquire the non-core assets of the company, the core assets of the company, which is a continuing enterprise. You could make investments in interim financing where you could get a super priority charge. You could invest in security receipts, which are issued by asset reconstruction companies, or you can securitize debt. All these options are ways and means by which financial investments into stressed asset or stressed asset companies can be undertaken. You have the unique advantage of taking a corporate debtor which is under liquidation and continue with it as a going concern, which is perhaps the most unique and I would say act of resurrection, almost Christ-like in relation to how this is happening in India, because the normal principle is that the company ceases to exist as a company once the liquidation order is passed. So this is again a unique example of the innovation that has taken place in the takeover code. Several listed companies have obviously been defaulting on their listing obligations are also available for acquisition so that the market access for capital is available. The Securities Exchange Board of India, realizing the issues of pumping in money for the purpose of acquiring shares as disadvantages compared to pumping in money in the company for its survival, and therefore has dispensed with the making of a public offer even when there is a change of control or even when there is a acquisition of shares which constitutes a majority trigger of in excess of 26% under the takeover code. Furthermore, since the company is a sick company or a distressed company, the prices on the market are unrelated in many ways to the reality of trading. You could have companies which have illiquid stock being ramped up by a majority or a majority of a minority. And those are therefore distortive principles by which prices can be determined. So the SEBI having understood that you could have a very distorted, unrelated market price, and therefore the average of 26 weeks or the average of highs and lows over a 6 month period are not considered today as the pricing principle for making an offer and acquiring shares. Additionally, it has been seen that the NCLT also engages in reduction of capital and therefore, in a sense, excising out the recalcitrant promoter and having him really surrender his shares at hardly any value, because shareholder consent is not required for the approval of a resolution plan, which is again a unique principle under our insolvency and bankruptcy code. So you could have a situation where old capital, which is unrepresented capital, being cancelled and fresh capital being infused into the company, which is really used for the purposes of the company rather than really used to pay off investors who have invested in a dud company or whose shareholding has become of a dud value. So these are some of the procedural advantages that have been created in the code. Mr. Sahu kindly explained the issues that there is now certainty. There is now certainty in the process because almost all the procedural issues and all the substantive issues that could be possibly raised against the bankruptcy court have been raised, and judgments of the Supreme Court have clarified the law. The constitutional validity of the law was also challenged, and that also has been upheld. So the possibility of challenging the code in its current form, current version, is negligible, or is perhaps now not there at all. In relation to the distribution principles and the competition between financial creditors and operational creditors, the law has also been fairly settled, and any value between 5% to 15% from the entire value received from a purchaser or from an acquirer has been seen in the case law and in the actions of the National Company Law Tribunal and the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal as being sufficient to pay off the operational creditors, because they cannot get a priority over the secured creditors. When there were aberrations raised by the National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, within a record time of 12 days, the legislature intervened and changed the law. I think this is perhaps the swiftest that any legislature has reacted to a judgment of an authority which completely distorted the banking principles under which secured creditors were to receive in higher priority than the unsecured creditors. So the promptness with which the legislature considered this special law is remarkable. And as Dr. Sahu has mentioned, there have been 5 legislative interventions in the act or the code. And this parliament, which is the monsoon session of parliament, is likely to adopt the ordinances as legislature, which will make it perhaps the 6th legislative change. It's a clean process in that the process has regulatory certainty. It's a prescriptive regulatory proceeding, and therefore the value maximization is the doctrine that has been adopted by the National Company Law Tribunal. It's an almost an auction-like procedure, though it is not necessary that one process, one method must be the only method by which there could be a change in control. Multiple scheme types can be proposed. You could have a merger process versus a demerger process, and the valuation would be equated, methods would be equated on the basis of the matrix of valuation that is given at the time when the proposal or request for proposal is sought for. One of the new advantages that is being discovered in the recent times when COVID has been rattling the markets and rattling the business is that there is a realization now that there are several companies sitting on large land banks. Now, to aggregate a large land bank under the land acquisition law is almost an impossibility in current times. So where you see a company which has a sufficient large bank which is vacant and which could be used for expanding new business or changing the business of the enterprise, which is the corporate debtor, there is an enormous opportunity of saving years effectively in acquiring such companies. And that is an opportunity which lots of enterprises are looking at. And that is an opportunity most foreign investors could also look at, because this is land which is industrial land. This is not land which is agricultural land. This is land which has a title which is vested appropriately in the corporate debtor and which could be acquired without any issues of agricultural ceiling laws. A lot of the issues around land law and creating a real estate company are just not there in the context of a company which has a large land bank. So from all perspectives, if you see it in terms of the realization value, I think the fact that there is distress means that there is a discount. And the distress is not such a thing that it is still high priced in the context of the stock exchange. Prices have actually fallen and are realistic. And therefore, the valuations which you would get in relation to a stressed asset would be far less than what you would get in the context of a healthy asset or a flourishing company. And therefore, this is a good time in the Indian context to invest into India. This is what I feel I wanted to emphasize in the context of the aspects which were not covered by the previous speakers. And I thank you so much for this opportunity for allowing me to make my points. Thank you so much.
Thank you, as always, Shardul, for providing deep insights from, you know, the wonderful perspectives that you always have, you know, on the subjects. May now turn to our Secretary General, Mr. Dilip Chinoy, for offering the vote of thanks, please. Mr. Chinoy, as you all know, is leading FICCI and, you know, he deals with a lot of government issues and hence has very deep policy insights in a lot of areas. Over to you.
Thank you, Jyoti. My only concern here is that we are 9 minutes over time, so I'm going to be very, very brief. His Excellency, Mr. Nandi Jaiswal, Council General of India in New York, thank you very much for your and your team's support for that. There in partnership, but I think to Dr. M.S. Sahu, Chairperson, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, IBBI, thank you, sir, for being here, for always, being so open and addressing all the issues. Thank you for accepting this joint invitation from the Council General and FICCI to be part of this session. To Mr. Rajesh Kumar, Chairman, State Bank of India, sir, as usual, you've always been very clear and candid in your address, also offering a partnership to the companies who would wish to access India. Also, thank you, Mr. Sunil Mehta, IBA, CEO IBA and former MD and CEO of Punjab National Bank. Thank you for being with us and thank you for your address. Thank you, Mr. Shardul Shah, for being with us and for leading this effort in FICCI. And of course, Mr. Rashesh Shah, Past President FICCI and Chairman and CEO Edelweiss Group. Thank you, Mr. Shah, for being with us. And I want to thank all the participants who have logged on. And I hope you will stay on for that. And thank you, Jyoti and team, for putting this together. I think with that, back to you, Jyoti.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chinoy. So we now move to the next session. The panelists of the next session to kindly stay online, and we'll be just starting in about a minute to the participants, so kindly bear with us. Abha, over to you. starting the next session, please.
Sure. Gaurav, please let us know when we can start.
Yes, yes, we are live.
Now begin with the next session, which is a panel discussion on investment opportunities in stressed assets. I request Mr. Sanjeev Krishnan, partner and leader deals, PricewaterhouseCoopers Private Limited, to kindly conduct the session. Over to you, Sanjeev.
Thanks, Abha, and good evening, everyone. Maybe a little bit more detail. We have Mr. Prakash Rao from NIF. We have Mr. Rajiv Ranjan Jha from BFC. We have Mr. Bhatia Bansal from Edelweiss. Rohit Santani from Avenue Capital. And Nipun from Apollo will provide us with the investors. And we're really looking forward to that. And we also have Mr. Barbuzer from SBI. I think we'll get some continued impressions of how the banking fraternity looks at the status of resolution so far. So until now, we heard a lot on what's been the progress and what is the impression that the progress on IBC and the resolution of the stress asset environment in India. Maybe I think it's time to maybe do a bit of a status check, and maybe I'd possibly start with getting Rohit and Nipun into the conversation to get their initial impressions about not just about what they've heard recently, but actually more so their experiences of attempting to invest in India and how they think the evolution has been over the last 18 months, and maybe more so what do they possibly think can be done in the near term to make it even more potent. So maybe we start with Rohit, and then maybe Nipun, we get your views. So Rohit, over to you.
Sure. Thanks, Sanjeev. I think, one thing that I would begin with is, after the implementation of IBC, what we did observe was a very sharp uptick in the amount of recoveries that asset reconstruction companies are making. And what you see is like a balanced shift towards creditors. And you have promoters coming in trying to settle their outstanding dues proactively, which you would not see otherwise. So I think that's been a very big big change because of IBC. And I think, seeing the opportunities and challenges across various sectors, I think, the way we look at the Indian market, you have three or four buckets of opportunities, starting with investing in high-yield private credit, which is essentially providing credit to companies which are performing and not necessarily NP or defaulted. And because of COVID, what we've seen in that sector is that you have the nature of opportunity has changed, and you have multiple sectors that you would otherwise not see as a distressed investor approach you for capital. So for example, retail, we've never really seen distress in retail in India over the last 7, 8, 10 years, but you're seeing that now. Similarly, commercial real estate, we do see some lease rental discounting transactions sort of coming back to market now. And you look at retail portfolios, that again is a new set of opportunities that we're seeing in the market because of COVID. So you know, keeping that sector aside, the other way we participate is obviously, you know, doing single credit restructurings, which is trying to buy debt of companies which have defaulted. And the idea there being essentially you buy the debt, aggregate the entire or majority of the debt, and do a financial restructuring followed by, if required, an operational turnaround. And that's a space which is, you know, it's very attractive. The opportunity set is very big. But I think there are some challenges that one needs to address if you're trying to invest in that sector of the opportunity. And, you know, the big one that comes out is really the ability to aggregate all the debt. The amount of time that it requires to aggregate majority of the debt sometimes could be 9 months, 12 months, 18 months. And sometimes you're not even able to get there. And I don't know what the solution there is for a problem like that, but that I feel is like a big hindrance in terms of getting to like a controlling position on the capital structure, after which you're able to resolve the account. I think the other issue that comes up when you're trying to do a single credit, large single credit restructuring is, you know, being able to outside an IBC process, which works very efficiently, but an outside NCLT or IBC process, if you're trying to do a settlement, it becomes extremely difficult to settle all the liabilities outside of just the lenders. So you could have statutory liabilities, you could have labor liabilities, you could have, you know, electricity bills unpaid, you could have a ton of other liabilities that could come back and bite an investor later. And the only way to sort of come clean and do a whitewash on the asset is to go through an NCLT process. And not necessarily all, you know, assets or companies fit into that process. Sometimes you want to work with the existing promoter. And if you're trying to do that outside of NCLT, then it becomes really challenging to sort of clean up all the other liabilities outside of an IBC process. Lastly, you know, I think one issue that we deal very often with is, you know, the income tax. I mean, actually, we are distressed investors, so you're buying assets on the cheap. But when you try to go and sell those assets at a certain price, there are valuation frameworks and guidelines, which is, you know, for example, Section 56 of income tax, you're trying to sell an asset where you cannot sell shares or securities below the underlying value of the land. Now, despite the fact that I may have bought it as a distressed investor at a certain price, and not having that ability to sell out at a discounted price in the market, that hurts to some extent, you know, restricts the amount of flexibility that investors have. I'll pause there, Sanjeev, and I think, you know, those are some of the issues that we sort of deal with on a day-to-day basis.
Thanks, Rohit. Nipun?
Hey, hi, Sanjeev. Thanks, Fiki, for the invite and, you know, sharing thoughts on this panel with the audience. So I think, you know, we should pat ourselves on the back for bringing such a, you know, framework. IBC was much, much required. I think the whole credit culture in the country has changed. There is definitely more balance, I would say, maybe in the favor of creditors now, which was for a long time, I think, you know, being discussed. So IBC is a huge, huge step forward. I think international investors recognize that. International investors have participated in several transactions which have happened over the last few years. And I think almost many deals, you know, it's hard. I don't have numbers top of my head, but I think the data is out there that in several transactions, while the Indian sponsor was the face, invariably the capital has been provided by an international investor, or the transaction has been done in partnership with an international investor. So I think India is probably one of the biggest NPL opportunities in Asia today. You know, the size and numbers are really large. It is across sectors. So in terms of the opportunity set and the framework, I think it's kind of all there. This pandemic is maybe more of a pause. I think obviously investors, doesn't matter whether it's NCLT related issues, but it could be any asset class. Outside of the public markets, private markets have been a little more cautious right now, but public markets have seen record amount of capital raising in India. Probably 2020 might be the worst year for the economy, but might end up being the best year for capital raising, because even players who did not need capital, well-capitalized companies and banks and other institutions, have kind of gone on a flurry of fundraising activity, but that's on the public market. I think private markets operate very differently. Time horizons of investment in public markets versus private markets cannot be compared. We are private market investors globally. We have over 400 billion AUM, invest across the capital structure from credit, mezzanine, high yield to common equity. Even in India, we've done all the products. And like us, several peers, groups of ours who are alternate asset investors on the private side are kind of, you know, assessing how this kind of restructuring plays out now, which has been proposed under the Kamath Committee, because I think that will probably be the first set. There are old cases in NCLT, you know, which obviously will be a focus area, but I think they expect there could be fallout because of the pandemic, where, you know, once the suspension of the IBC goes away, I think it was for 6 months, one will have to see, you know, how do lenders behave. So our view is that lenders will be using this opportunity to restructure a lot so that that does not happen, which is a good thing. I think for the financial system, that's a good thing. But a few things which I think, given the experience with IBC and given everybody understands it really well, and, you know, the, I would say, the relative success of the system, I think rather than, you know, keep looking backward of all that we have done, there are still things to be done which can make it even better. The capital for this, the domestic capital pool is really shallow, especially on the risk capital. You know, banks and financial institutions, as well as domestic private equity funds, I think can participate. But the size of this opportunity is very large. I think the domestic capital pool will fall way short of providing any meaningful amount of capital. So for international investors, I think there are a few things. While IBC provides one route, and Rohit touched on it briefly, you do want to kind of work even with existing sponsors to figure out a resolution pre-IBC. And I think it's time that that framework of IBC kind of gets extended on policymaking side, to not only kind of the policymaking framework once in IBC is well understood, but I think there's still confusion around the policymaking framework just pre-IBC if you want to do resolutions. And I think the case over there is that, you know, even if you are a super senior lender, and this is a very specific point, and if there are policymakers, and I think various platforms have represented to the government, including to IBBI, and there have been even discussions and calls and representations to the effect. But if in a capital stack, the senior lenders have agreed to take a back seat and allowed new capital to come in through a super senior structure called, like, say, the DIP financing, but pre kind of a company going into bankruptcy, that's not respected if the company then goes into bankruptcy. So if pre-bankruptcy you had a capital stack where lenders had foregone or taken like a second charge and a new set of lenders had come in, but if that same company does go into bankruptcy, this structure doesn't hold. The structure collapses and it does not recognize the seniority of the new creditor coming in versus the old creditors. And hence, I think it's forcing companies or investors to wait, because otherwise I think there is a step even before where foreign investors or domestic investors can really proactively prevent companies from getting into IBC. However, the situation currently is that in the absence of clarification on this one specific point, investors would wait to see that, okay, you know, if that is not going to be allowed, then why not wait for the company to go into bankruptcy and then look at it as an opportunity, which is okay from a policy, but I think it takes delay in resolution. It kind of creates, why should the resolution process not be respected in the IBC of the capital structure which is available? So basically the RP just needs to recognize any intercreditor agreement which is in place pre-IBC. The IBC code does not recognize an intercreditor. And I think that simple change can go a long way in kind of, you know, moving. We have done a lot. I think we can take kind of credit on what framework we've created. But I think what we are trying to debate and discuss today and obviously through FICCI maybe recommend to policymakers is how to make it more robust, how to kind of look forward and go to the next stage of what IBC should be. So I think I'll take a pause at that now there, and we can come back on this or some other angle on this. But the only other thing I'll add is it's all about execution. It's not about the opportunity. The opportunity is well understood in India. It's about execution. And I think that is the tougher part, given some of the nuances which are there, which around tax, which was touched upon, around withholding tax, there's another angle. Now we have an ARC angle to it, which I'm sure co-panelists will touch on. So I think it's time that now we kind of go to the next stage of what are the changes needed in the policy to make it even more efficient for resolution.
Thanks, Nipun. I think you make a wonderful point about, the protection which is available under the IBC to interim finance not being available to anything, a super senior debt in the pre-IBC basis. Clearly one of the areas to focus on. Just in the interest of time, maybe I'll move on to Mr. Rao. Mr. Rao, you have been at the forefront of this. You have three funds working in this segment, multiple platforms that you have set up, and where you're trying to aggregate a bunch of assets also. What's been your experience, really, to supplement whatever Nipun and Abhirohit said?
Yeah, thanks, Sanjeev. That's a great question, and I can just relate to what both Rohit and Nipun have just mentioned. But before I get into to answering your question, I just want to give a flavor of what NIIF is and how we have been set up. I'll quickly give that. So the National Investment and Infrastructure Fund is a quasi-sovereign wealth fund that the Government of India has conceived. The Government of India has given us $3 billion of capital commitment, and we are in the process of raising another $3 billion as external capital. We have set up three funds. The first fund is a core infrastructure fund. It's a $2.1 billion fund. We have reached the target, and the idea is to aggregate assets, both stressed assets and operator and otherwise available assets, particularly in the infrastructure space. And these platforms are running actually on professional lines, and we have set up these platforms in partnership with international operators. For example, we have a ports and logistics platform that we had set up with Dubai Ports, DP World, and all the ports and logistics of assets are aggregated under that. Similarly, we have set up a road sector platform with Rodis, which is a Spanish company owned by PSP of Canada. And we have also done a renewable energy platform with CDC of UK. It's called the INR Renewable Energy. More importantly, I think, and of course, we have the other two funds which operate in sectors like clean energy, climate, affordable housing, and healthcare, and things like that. Now, the first fund that I have talked about, the Core Infrastructure Fund, has access to roughly about $5 billion of capital with a co-investment pool of another $3 billion. These platforms, I'll just share my experience of acquiring just two stressed road assets. We have just acquired it. We haven't, in fact, made it public yet, but in the next 1 week, we will be doing that. So the way I think the investors have to look at it is how exactly we are able to do this before IBC in conversation with the lender. And if you have, I know multiple lenders will lead to a few months delay, a couple of months delay, but my view is at the IBC, what happens is you're getting a clean asset, no doubt about it, but it is bid out aggressively, and it's almost like, everybody wants to make a huge return on that, and nobody really is able to make returns. So my view is before IBC, there is a huge amount of opportunity with the lenders, and we have in these road assets, we have been able to discuss with the lenders. They were willing to take a haircut And our taking over of the assets has also been quite smooth. We had to go to the National Highway Authority of India to get the approvals, which have taken maybe a month or so. But overall, I think there is an interest on the part of the governmental agencies, the lenders, the regulators, everyone actually to enable a smooth process of transfer of the assets. I think that this is the greatest thing that has evolved maybe in the last 4 years post IBC. I had been with the bank, State Bank of India myself, and there was the Reserve Bank of India, right from BIFR to DRD to the current structure. Every time we have been trying to do something on resolution of the stressed assets, I think to a great extent, India has evolved, and currently there is a huge opportunity. And I think NIIF is also positioned to take advantage of this opportunity. And one final point I want to make: in all these acquisitions in India, investment in India, if you have a local partner whose governance is high and who has the ability to connect with the various stakeholders, I think the process will become much, much smoother. Maybe I can also mark it the way Rajneesh Kumar had said, NIIF should be the partner of choice, because we are 49% owned by the government, and $3 billion of capital has come from the government. Thank you, Sanjeev. I'll pause at this.
Mr. Bansal, maybe we'll move to you. You know, you've been on the banking side, and now you are actively on the there have been a couple of significant changes, or particularly on the ARCs, and you know, there have been rulings which for assets under PC. I think that's one of the issues that has come up. The second issue really has been with FPIs being directly allowed to invest in debt in India. So I think it'll be good to get your perspective on these two items, and then particularly the second item, we'll sort of get some other views as well, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Sanjeev ji, and thanks, Vicky, for giving this opportunity. So basically, the market, as Rajneesh ji also said, the market is good enough. The size is almost 10 lakh crore into India for NPA, but he slightly made a different statement also. So if you really see today, the stress asset in India, and during the last 3-4 years after RBI AQR, if we take 10 lakh crore figure also, and if we exclude retail, SME, agri, so we are talking of corporate stress of almost 6 lakh crore or so. And after steel having got resolved through IBC mainly, most of the stress today we are seeing in power, retail and power, and then after roads, as Mr. Rao mentioned, EPC companies, mid-sized steel plants, and now the new category, which is NBFC and retail loans, as Rohit also mentioned some extent. I think opportunities are huge. Restructuring has been tried in India, and as Mr. Rao also mentioned, that perhaps the best solution can be outside IBC, pre-IBC, which I think now SAUSAV is also trying for pre-PACS, which is likely to come soon in IBC, but that is again through IBC. So there is still a lack of clarity that if we do something outside IBC, whether we get rid of a lot of liabilities, which is still not 100% clear, though government has recently issued a notification under SARFAESI Act, clarifying that position almost equivalent to IBC. But I think government departments being sometimes they take action in a different way. So I think there is a good opportunity in power and roads, and especially then we have good opportunity in mid-sized steel plant, but there may not be fund, guys may not be interested that way. Now, coming to your specific questions, let me first come to your question on ARCs. See, ARC model, when started under SARFAESI Act, was mainly as a agency model. RBI, when started ARCs, the idea was that they will be able to manage, resolve, restructure the asset. And there was no investment requirement, actually, by the way, for ARCs. Then slowly they realized that there has to be some skin in the game. Then they introduced 5% concept. And during Raghuram Rajan Saab time, he made it 15, thinking that the right valuations will happen, and which really happened, though it took some time. But then the problem by that 15% norm was that ARCs are not that well capitalized, and banking system doesn't support that much ARCs by lending money. And that also has come to some extent from regulatory perspective, that they feel by giving money, banks start giving money to ARCs as if they are doing evergreening. So that confusion is still there. But as of today, if you want to acquire stress asset from anywhere else, I think ARC is the best forum, except that we have been requesting RBI that 15% norm is unnecessary, especially in the deals which are happening in cash deals now. This 15% norm was good when 85% was with the lenders only. So we wanted a skin in the game. But then when you are asking for buyers of these assets to pay full in cash, then I don't find any requirement of 15%, because then ARCs are not in a position to pay that. That is why we need these stress asset funds and investment by outside the country. Now, as I think RBI has issued draft guideline, whereby perhaps they are proposing that FIIs and FPIs, etc., can invest directly in the stress asset, so they can take assignment of these loans. So perhaps this constraint on ARCs will get sold. Though I still feel you will need still some Indian presence, because the time given by the banking system for due diligence is quite less. So if I am sitting in US or in Singapore, may not be feasible. So you will still need, like Nipun and Rohit at least are sitting in India, so they at least they can provide that facility. But then many funds may not have the Indian presence. So you, it's not a bad idea if RBI reduces this 15% and still you go through an ARC, but otherwise, you will need some presence. So most of these funds today, the new ARCs are coming actually by the funds, whether it is Bain, whether it is Lone Star, whether it is Varde. I mean, everyone is coming through this ARC for their fund investment. So I, down the second question was on this, whether ARCs can bid for the IBC assets. I mean, my view is slightly contrary to ARCs actually, frankly. ARCs were meant for restructured and resolved assets. They were allowed to take equity stake by way of conversion of loan. So technically, they were never allowed to buy equity, and they were never allowed to run the businesses other than what is allowed under SARFAESI Act. So there was no confusion, at least to our mind. So that's why we never bid in that sense. But there is no bar in bidding and being a resolution applicant along with some strategic investor, along with some equity investor. That is how it is supposed to be done. Like say, we have seen that GM ARC bidding in Alok Textile, even RCL bidding in along with Varde partner, let us say in Uttam. And we have also tried in one or two cases. Other ARCs have also tried. I think the controversy arose perhaps in one or two cases where ARCs tried to give a plan, and which was virtually, I think, in a different type of plan, that I will realize the asset and pay to the lenders and with taking some equity stake. I think I don't find it's a big issue. Maybe it is just being made an issue between regulators unnecessary. So I think that what ARCs are supposed to do, they should do that.
Thank you, sir. That your views are very clear on that, and time permitting to others. And also your views on the FPI, FII matter. I think we'll go back to Rohit and Nipun on that. But just in the interest of time, I want to get Mr. Jha and Mr. Barbuzer into the debate. So Mr. Jha, maybe we'll start with you. What have your experiences been on the insolvency code? I mean, again, we have heard the changes, we heard the amendments and how they're facilitating a lot of resolutions. Power, of course, as Mr. Bansal also mentioned, has been one of the key sectors, and you have been at the forefront of it, Mr. Jha. What have been your experiences so far on resolution of power asset stress through the IBC?
First of all, I would like to extend thank Sanjeev ji and also to Fiki to giving me this opportunity to speak on this very relevant issue and and very like a burning issue, I would say. Say, as far as IBC is concerned, I always feel that IBC has been a wonderful concept. And once this has been, the code has been enacted, then it was always felt that it would pave the way for the quick recovery for the lenders if they are unable to resolve within the available framework of RBI. But because I belong to power sectors, I will speak on specifically issues related to power sector. And in the power sector, what we have felt, being a major largest financier, say power sector has been facing a lot of problems with respect to the DISCOM issue, with respect to the PPA issue, with respect to the coal supply issue, because majority of the stress assets belong to coal-based power projects. And the assets which have gone into NCLT, they have actually not brought the value to the lenders, the very intent with which lenders have gone to the IBC. And precisely because of the reason, because the factors which were the responsible for bringing those assets into a stress have not been addressed. But of late, in last 3-4 years, because this stress in power sector has started almost 4-5 years back, and it has continued. But of late, government has recognized that and taken many corrective action with regard to with regard to regulation, with regard to PPAs and even DISCOMs. And as you can note that very recently, government has formulated Atmanirbhar scheme, and under that, PFC and REC both have disbursed 90,000 crore, and through which the power sector entrepreneurs, they have got some money which were pending for a long time. So IBC, and I would quite agree with my co-panelist views that domestic capital pool is very shallow, and this is the reason, this is also one of the major reason why these power assets have not brought the value. And and today this is the forum where international investors are available, and I would like to tell them the situation in power sector has improved drastically, and the kind of initiative which has been taken by government, things are looking much better, because whatever value which have been given in the NCLT based on the resolution which have been done up till now is almost less than 50% or 40% of the value, which is not exactly, which should not be the case. But with these reforms, we feel that the value would be higher. So my request and my feeling is that IBC is one platform where it's like, if you go to IBC, the arbitration or the liabilities can get settled, and people can have a liability, such kind of litigation free company or arbitration free company, and they can work. But even if it is not in IBC, if it is prior to that, because we have found that certain assets who are languishing for funds, and banks are reluctant rather to fund them, with respect to working capital, with respect to that additional last mile fund which can take them to successful completion and ultimately generation of revenue. And this has been lacking. So again, the role of investor is to come in and support those projects, because power sector is a very simple sector. It's not complicated at all. But because of some issues, it's like in last 4-5 years, things have got complicated, but slowly I feel that power sector is turning around and things are looking better. And things have to look better, because India is a developing economy and the power consumption is going to rise if you leave aside COVID era, but still after that, the power consumption has gone to the older levels, and it is expected to rise because it is being a developing economy. We have to develop a lot of infrastructure. Power is an important input, and with the consumption of power increasing, we feel that power sector has a lot of scope for growth. So returns are more or less assured. So that is what the intent is, that even prior to IBC also, if an asset which can be restructured, if the investors can support, it can fetch them good returns. So that is what my understanding of the entire thing is.
Thanks, Mr. Jha. Mr. Baghuza, your views on the progress of IBC and your experience.
Yeah, thanks, Sanjeevji, and good evening to everyone. This is really a game changer, particularly in the on account of the lenders. In fact, if you go to this NCLT or IBC code, prior to that, there are several regulators have issued some guidelines. But those who are not more kind of useful, and most of the account which were restructured under CDR and even S4A or this is 525. So basically, those could not take place properly in which the account was considered or envisaged. And after this IBC code in 2016, then really it was a game changer for the lenders. Reason being, this is a direct shift from the debtor in possession to the creditor in control. And this was initially, it was not understood properly by the stakeholder. But over a period of time, now the particularly the promoter director of the company, corporate debtors, they have understood it properly. And as so many speakers already spoken over that, this is how basically it is success. And my chairman himself and Dr. Shahu and other senior people, they have already given in detail this how basically it is success. Recently, as far as SBI is concerned, so we have around 851 cases basically filed in CRP, either directly by SBI or we are here in the consortium or multiple bank. Around 1 lakh crore of cases filed by us directly in the different NCLTs, and the same kind of number where the other co-lenders file the CRP application, we join that. And outcome from that NCLT is really in 2019-20, it was marvelous, though a few high-value cases resolved, and in fact, the name of those cases already mentioned by the senior speakers. Around 40% of total recovery of SBI particularly came from that. But this is not only this, we experienced that recovery, but at the same time, this one lesson taught to the promoter director, this is a financial discipline. This is, I think it is, it was required for a long time, and that lesson has now taught to them. And now these people, particularly, they are trying their best to resolve wherever default is there from other means also, like Bansal sir is here through ARC, or like funds are there, so raising fund either from foreign fund or from other investor and settle this account through compromise. And whatever way, basically, and even refinancing is also some funds basically also coming forward. And earlier, the promoter of the company not inclined to dilute their stake in the company in respect of their equity. Now they are mentally prepared, and really this is a game changer, we can say. And during this period, 94 cases pertaining to SBI have been resolved, and this is of 65,000 crore of cases. So this is not a small case, and even our CRP cases are still going on. These are also a high number. This is 318 cases still going on, and involving amount of 61,000. Over a period of time, initially, basically, the financial creditor were also not in a proper kind of understanding, particularly what are the responsibility, right, and responsibility of the COC. But over a period of time, now almost all lenders have understood the proper thing. And now the COC, they are also behaving almost in a proper manner. So this is also this thing, and our legal side also, leading corporate legal counsels, basically now they are also fully kind of updated on that and fully familiar with the entire thing, and they are providing and extending all kind of support to the lenders. And in respect of infrastructure, in fact, Dr. Sahu has really done a marvelous job in infrastructure in respect of increasing the tribunal as well as other related infrastructure or ecosystem, basically they try to provide. And as my chairman said in the keynote, that this is a coordinated effort. Lenders, wherever facing any difficulty, we are raising that point to MCA, DFS, and other IBBI and other stakeholders, and they were considering the real whatever difficulties are there and providing, trying to provide a solution to that. So this is really on this IBC. It is a game changer, and even this is, in fact, everybody has experience in our country that group insolvency is not so far mentioned in our IBC notification, is not that, but this is also visible in one of the our case, that Videocon, that 13 company were consolidated by the Honorable NCLT Mumbai in August 2019, and that resolution is going almost now we are going to achieve the milestone. And another, this is a case happen in IBC, that is cross border case, and that Airways, basically everybody is aware of about that also, that cross border insolvency also basically experiencing that particularly from the Amsterdam. So few development happen, and now this have paved the way then basically. And as my co-panelist discuss about the pre-pack, really pre-pack is required as on date. Reason being, this our tribunal are also now flooded with the cases, and there would be some kind of out of this NCLT. If we will agree to some kind of resolution, and with the resolution we will go to that NCLT, then probably it will protect the value of the company. So these are my point, Sanjeev ji, on IBC. And hope this time to come, it a little few challenges are there, and probably the Honorable Supreme Court to settle those challenges are also, we are on the right track.
Thank you, Mr. Vagudar, and time permitting, I'll come back to you, particularly on the on the 6th August circular. But Anoop, I just want to get you, Mr. Vagudar talked about pre-packs. And I think that is one area where I'm sure a lot of investors would want to understand what's happening. And maybe if you can keep your comments to, you know, not the MSMEs, because maybe the investors would possibly not be too focused on MSMEs, but prepacks, what is the development on prepacks in India in general? That'll be very helpful, Anu. Anu? Go ahead, Anu, please.
Anu, we are not able to hear.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. No, it's okay. Sorry.
Go ahead. Technical glitch, yeah. Oh, I think I exhausted my 30 seconds or so. So I was saying that, you know, the pre-pack discussion, you know, it's a very hot discussion. You know, it comes up around the insolvency. Why, you know, we in a successes in the insolvency law, but the major concern that it takes to resolve.
Anoop, we are struggling to hear you.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yeah, much better, much better. Okay. Please go ahead.
Sorry. So what I was saying is that, you know, the while, you know, we have successes in the insolvency resolution processes, but the one thing that is troubling the whole system, the process, is the time that it takes to resolve. And it's a time value of money that is in the, that's a question today. So therefore, you know, the time needs to be respected. And therefore, I think from that perspective, the prepacks not only assures that the things will be done in a faster way, it also gives a lot of certainty about the result of the insolvency resolution process. Unlike today, when the lenders run the whole process for 180 and in many cases up to 365, in many cases 500 days, and then moves to a liquidation, and by that time much of the value is allocated to the resolution process costs and the liquidation costs. And therefore, prepacks in that way is a very cost-efficient method. Serves the purpose of the insolvency court, which is a timely resolution. And it also gives a lot of certainty. But, you know, I think that while prepack is a good thought, there are certain issues, you know, that we must resolve before the prepack framework is implemented. You know, one of that issue is, you know, how do you ensure that the benefit of a moratorium, which is available to an insolvency process, is also available to a prepack process. The moratorium is a very, very important aspect. It gives a calm period. It does not deviate from the resolution attempts. So I think moratorium is a very serious aspect that needs to be thought through while attempting a prepack. Maybe some mechanism where the initiation of the prepack itself gives a moratorium against the distractions. One would definitely include restriction on the enforcement proceedings. Others would be initiating litigation proceedings against the company. Similarly, I think the other issues that needs to be addressed is more of a perception of abuse. That, you know, how you make sure that that the prepack process would not be subjected to abuse, would not be used as a methods used by the existing management to buy back the assets at a cheaper price. And that is where the questions of Section 29A comes in. I think one of the thought around prepack is that Section 29A applicability should be diluted to the extent that an NPA should not disallow a promoter to propose a prepack. I think that is very critical also from a perspective of a investor who are not the strategic investor but the financial investors, and who largely depend on involvement of the promoters when they come in. So I think some of these issues are very, very critical before we introduce prepack. It's very briefly, I mean, Sanjeev, there's a lot to talk about prepack, but, you know, given the time constraint, I mean, over to you.
Thanks, Anoop. Thanks. So maybe we'll sort of we have about 5 to 10 minutes. Maybe lots of time. Maybe go back to Nipun and Rohit and take their views on FPIs and FIIs actually being allowed to take on debt directly now. From an investing community standpoint, Nipun and Rohit, how do you see that? And do you think it sort of encourages more direct investments and more facilitates those a little bit more today?
I think, so Sanjeev, on that point, you know, if you look at the nature of investment opportunity, you know, on the distressed side, it really go in and buy debt of companies going through some stress. You know, either you have balance sheet stress or you have operational stress, and sometimes you have both. So what foreign investors or any investor needs to do in this situation is come in, acquire probably senior claims, maybe all the claims in the company, try to do a balance sheet restructuring, then do an operational turnaround if required. And all of this requires, you know, a lot of effort. And what it requires is type of capital that is more stable and long-term in nature. So you need to really commit to the market for like a 5 to 7 year period. And you need to commit to getting those resources on the ground, like Mr. Bansal mentioned, or like Mr. Rashish Shah initially mentioned, that, you know, you need capital that is flexible, that is long-term, and that is tight, locked up for like 5 to 7 year period. Now, if you put all of this together, you know, the need to go and buy an ARC is quite apparent. And what you're really asking foreign investors to do when you're setting up an ARC or buying one, the requirement is not that high. All you have to meet is like a net worth requirement of 100 crores. And you get the benefit of being able to use SARFAESI and other laws. So if you look at the nature of investment opportunity and what you're really asking foreign investors to do to access the opportunity, it's not a lot to ask. So, you know, when you get feedback from these, some of the foreign investors who say that, you know, we want direct access, we don't want to go through an asset reconstruction company or set up our own. And the common reasons that they say is, A, we have to pay fees, B, you know, we have to go through like a two-tier committee approval process because an ARC needs to approve as well. And I feel that you need to distinguish the type of investors who want to play in this market. There are those investors who are long-term committed to the market for 5, 7, 10 years, 20 years. And you would observe that a lot of them have already set up their own asset reconstruction companies or invested in existing asset reconstruction companies. And then you have investors who really want to take advantage of a secondary trading opportunity, which is, you know, buy debt and probably trade out in 3 to 6 months or 1 year's time. And I feel a lot of these requests maybe are coming from capital that may be hot capital, and it may not solve, you know, or help the whole restructuring and, you know, what you want to do with the assets on the ground. I mean, you may end up in a situation where the debt is actually owned by 5 or 7 other diverse investors all over the world, and everybody talking different language from a restructuring perspective. It could be challenging from that perspective. Back to you.
I think that's a good point, Rai. You made a very good point. And Nipun, any views you have on this?
Yeah, very quickly, I don't think it'll go. I think the market does not have the maturity yet to price loans. I think if, let's say, 2/3 of the Indian market and NPA is with public sector banks, you know, who's going to price it? Like, how does, there is no, there are not enough benchmarks here. And I think with the kind of, you know, background of potential investigation into selling debt at discounts, you know, how did it get priced? You know, who decided the price? I really don't know. I think we have there is an existing way, or the bankruptcy route is there, but I doubt, given it's a loan market and not a bond market, the bond market holders can do it pretty quickly, right? Like mutual funds trying to sell it out, or bond holders trying to exit and pricing, that already happens even without bankruptcy. You know, in this pandemic, a lot of companies, because of just, you know, market liquidity in the early days in April, even high quality bonds had started trading at a discount in international markets, and there are bonds, you know, so that's a different kind of business. I think extending that to this is kind of, I think in the short term is over ambitious. Maybe the market can evolve in that direction at best, but I don't think that's the path to resolution. You know, that's kind of maybe shorter term views from investors. I really don't think, I think we're heading in that direction. I think today, I think what is being referred to as pre-packs is kind of the way to expand the market for resolutions fairly quickly. One way to do it is, rather than, you know, think of a new act and, you know, kind of trying and amending and creating a pre kind of bankruptcy process, just to start on intercreditor. I think that simple process would help resolve a lot of issues where the capital structure is respected. You know, the process of IBC is really what? The equity gets wiped out and the debt kind of becomes the equity, or new equity comes in to take care of the old debt. I think if that is the focus area, I think we will be able to achieve the objectives of much faster resolutions, than trying to go down the route of buying out of loans and aggregating of loans, which I really don't think in the Indian context, the timing of that is right. I don't think the market is there on the curve. Very few markets actually operate like that globally. Very few markets, even in the Western European markets, there are very few. The bond markets are more efficient, but India is not a bond market. India doesn't have a bond market. That's why the discounted buying of debt does not happen. It's a loan market. And that's the distinction why I think for us, it's better suited. The bondholders will tag along to this process of resolution. They have a seat on the table. But I think given the size of the problem and where the problem sits and the stakeholders involved, I think having something pre-bankruptcy, you know, even if it's one or two things, it's already been done in case of Swami Fund. They've been given the rights. The intercreditor will be respected in case of the Swami Fund, which was set up only for real estate, 25,000 crores. You just have to extend that definition to other funds. You know, why only for Swami? Why not just keep it that way? And the prepack can keep happening. But don't take, you know, another 4 years, 3 years to come to the perfect solution when a good solution can solve, you know, let's say 70%, 60% or whatever percent of the problem. So let not perfection be the enemy of good.
Well said, Nipun. Very well said. Very quickly, I think I think in the, you know, one of the things that the June 6th circular says is it's actually made the intercreditor agreement mandatory almost. It actually makes it mandatory. If 75% of value by value creditors agree and 60% by number, you know, do you believe that if the same thing were to be put in the June 7th circular of last year, that can help more resolutions? We have seen four or five pursuant to the June 7th circular. But if the intercreditor agreement were to be made mandatory, do you think we can see more resolutions happen?
Yeah, Sanjeev ji, you rightly said. In fact, Seon June circular 2019, and if you'll see that, according to that, all lender to sign the IC for resolution. So before taking any resolution, this is really a concern and a challenge for the particularly lead bank. And in most of the cases, we are the lead bank. And we tried to present the co-lenders that why basically this is resolution is required out of the NCLT and without kind of legal measure. Reason being, certain companies are really working well and there is no kind of doubt on their integrity of the promoter. Forensic audit is clear, willful default is not there, and financial activity is going on. And just to keep a company as a going concern and contribute to the economy of the country, that restructuring is the best possible solution for that resolving the default. For this purpose, in fact, as per the CMU circular, this is a clear guidelines under section, under item number 10, it is given in the circular that before taking up any resolution, all lenders to sign the ICA, but it is almost it is not happening. Reason being, there are multiple lenders in a large corporate, and not only multiple lenders, even multiple regulators are also there of those lenders. And some lenders basically they are telling that, see, this is guidelines are not applicable even to us. So this is this concern we have escalated to our regulator through a proper channel. And they have examined this entire difficulty, and basically the case wise they are also reviewing, and at the time of supervisory review of the individual bank, basically they were also reviewing why basically any bank has not signed, what were the reason, why basically whether non-signing ICA, whether bank will be in a kind of a beneficial position or it is a kind of some threat. So this kind of SSM supervisory review RBI is doing when they are conducting the individual bank audit. Really, if as per the 6th August circular and this clarification given on 7th of September by the regulator, that 75% by value and 60% by number, if it is ICA sign, or then it will be applicable to all. Now it has made a regulatory compliance, and now probably everybody has to come forward and they have to execute the ICA, and really it's required as per this Seongjun circular also. Reason being, this is only a special window provided by the regulator on 6th of August. Basically, the economic activity or the corporates company which are impacted by COVID only. So this is a very limited kind of scope is there, and a limited timeline is also there up to 31st of December 2020. So for this purpose, really it is required that ICA, like a regulatory compliance made by the regulator in 7th September circular, if those will also come for the prudential framework 7th June circular, it will be benefit for all the stakeholders, particularly the lenders and the corporates.
Thank you, Mr. Baguza. Mr. Jha, any quick comments on the...
Yeah, actually, say NCLT power assets, if you talk about, say, there are many assets which have gone to NCLT, but as I said in my earlier part, that the valuation, it has not faced the expected one. And what we feel that that marketing effort on account of those assets which are in NCLT, so that the true picture can be presented before the prospective resolution applicant, that has not been done. And at least in PFC, we have started doing that. Unfortunately, because of COVID, things have not been happening as we envisaged. But we started that so that we can take a, we can have a value. And we propose to have some roadshow. Because as I said, again, I am endorsing that viewpoint that the domestic capital pool is shallow. And we are seeing that only 3-4 famous resolution applicant is coming time and again for power sector. And if you talk about the valuation, I think people, our co-panelists have touched upon the valuation. The valuation of a power asset has not gone down substantially overnight. But it appears that it is almost like 40% or 30% kind of thing. So there has to be some kind of some improvement in NCLT process. Even the quick admission is one of the issue. Like we have faced that even the admission part is also taking a lot of time, and the implementation part also. And there are certain amendments which are happening. And I feel that with all those kinds of initiatives, things are likely to improve. And especially for power sector, we feel that if those things are taken care of, the valuation would be far higher. And it will serve the real purpose. So that is what I wanted to say. And restructuring also can't be ruled out and should not be ruled out, because restructuring is something where lenders would continue to get associated. And if there is any upside, especially in power sector, we are sincerely hoping that there will always, because it is a long-term investment. So it is going to be there, and then lenders can take some something out of that. So this is something like IBC should not be the only way through which the resolution of stress asset can be thought of.
Mr. Jha, Anu, last quick question comes from you. I think the question which is being asked is that any measures to shrink the IBC proceeding to a reasonable time frame take advantage of the market forces by potential investors. Your views?
Yeah, I think that's a very pertinent question, because there are a lot of delays right now in the process. So I think the first measure that need to take place is the admission of the insolvency proceeding as such. I think once the record of default is available from the information utilities, after that, NCLTs, the tribunals should not go any further, and it should be a mandatory admission. I think that will cut down on most of the time that is taken, and also it will cut down on the opportunities that the promoters or the management get to sort of mishandle the asset during this particular period. because this is the period between the filing and the admission where promoters know that, you know, after admission they will be gone forever, and the chances of siphoning off are most, and therefore for the preservation of the value of asset, for a quicker resolution, it is first one measure, one very important measure that need to be implemented. I think the other one is to sort of decongest the tribunals by taking away a lot of ancillary proceedings from NCLT and giving to specialized agencies, like, you know, the fraudulent transactions, the undervalued transactions, or the preferential transactions. The NCLT, neither they have the time nor the expertise to go into these issues, because these are very, very fact-driven. You have to run a lot of evidences on these transactions. So I think if we can decongest the tribunal, and also some specialized benches can be you know, put up for approval of the plans. There are, of course, you know, dedicated benches who look at the insolvency cases. But I think even in addition to that, if there are specialized benches who are only looking at the approval of the plan, that will cut, again, you know, cut down on the timelines. So very briefly, Sanjeev, these are, you know, top of my mind, which, you know, I could think of here.
Thanks, Anoop. Mr. Bansal, and our last question for you. You have been both, and your institutions have been partners to organizations who have been coming to India to help resolve the stress asset situation in India. Any words from you as to how potential investors could sort of be part of this journey?
So, Sanjeev, if I may go first, I think like Rohit said, what they need to have is long-term stable capital, take a longer-term view in the Indian market. So that's one thing that I would definitely advocate. And second thing is that, you know, you need to, it's almost like a myth that public sector banks are not in a position to really take decisions because of the investigations and all that. Most of the banks have put in place policies, and they have within those policies, a lot of resolution is happening. You need to engage with the lenders in a manner that they are able to come out, they're comfortable. Third thing is, don't have, you know, factor in 25-30% returns when you get into an investment into a stressed asset. What my view is, you need to you need to underwrite maybe 18-20% return and create value for yourselves, because there are so many opportunities to create value once you acquire the asset, because India is a growth story. So these are a few last thoughts from my side.
Yeah, so I have only 2 points to make. We have co-investors in our stress asset fund, as well as we have been getting co-investors in our individual deals also. So I think both the options work good. It depends, like, if you want to have a very long-term investment, better to come in stress asset fund. Like, we are running a fund of $1.3 billion, or Mr. Rao also is mentioned. The other option is when funds can buy with the ARC. So ARC is the only challenge, as we discussed, is that 15%. But 85% security receipt can be bought by them, because that avoids their setting up in India. And maybe, because as I mentioned, Indian banks or lenders give very less time. Even IBC, the RP just gives 30 days time to look into that diligence, which is very difficult for any overseas entity or fund to do full due diligence. So maybe that can be provided by the ARCs. But I think both sides, it is okay. And once RBI allows directly, maybe they can think of that. But I will still feel they will still need some Indian help, whether through Mr. Rao or whether through ARCs or whether through you, Sanjeev.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Bansal. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, all the panelists. Adi, that positive note, so I think it's almost time to hand it back to Abba. But once again, and of course to all the panelists for the time late in this evening. I'm sure we had an enthralling conversation and be useful to all the listeners. Back to you, Abba.
Thank you.
On behalf of Fiki, let me thank each one of the panelists for sharing their insights with us.
How's it going?
And thank you to the participants who have stayed with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Sanjeev.
Thank you.
Thanks.